I'm delighted to be at the Tajik National University today. The seat of learning has played a defining role in the making of Tajikistan and continues to illuminate and guide its vision and progress. Your country and Central Asia, the great centers of learning and culture, Samarkand and Kuzan, have nurtured the spirit of creativity and inquiry for centuries. You are proud flag bearers of that enlightened scholastic tradition of the vice of Rudaki and Bedi, from which not just this region, but the entire world continues to draw sustenance and inspiration. I have chosen to speak on the topic Countering Radicalization, Challenges Before Modern Society, for two reasons. First, your country has done commendable work to tackle this global menace and foster peace for one and all, and the world must recognize it. Second, the battle against terrorism, extremism, and radicalism must be fought first and foremost in the minds of people between those who believe in peace, love, and humanity, and those who feed on hatred, death, and destruction. It is a battle of opposing ideas of humanity on one hand and a make-believe world on the other. Talking to the youth, our future and the scholars, our guide and pathfinders, therefore becomes essential. As the President of India, I am visitor of 160 universities and institutions of higher learning. This has given me an opportunity to frequently speak to the youth in my country as well. My dear students, our two countries have much in common. Our histories are rooted in inclusive and tolerant values. All religions and thoughts have prospered and blossomed in the land of the Pamir and Himalayas. Today, we are confronted with those who wish to burn and destroy the fabric of our faiths, the embrace of our togetherness. The people of this country have made enormous sacrifice to stop the surge of bigotry and faith-based regressive ideas from capturing center stage. This not only saved your budding republic in the 1990s, but also firewalled your neighboring Central Asian republics. They too were then struggling with challenges that young nations face. We strongly hope there is deeper understanding of the geopolitical significance of the Tajik Civil War. Ladies and gentlemen, today, as you can see around you, there are renewed attempts to impose obscuran twist thoughts on peaceful scientist societies. This is a threatening the very foundation of human civilization. Their targets are people and societies who value progressive life and respect diversity of faiths and cultures. Notwithstanding your historic struggle and subsequent victory in the civil war, the long-drawn war is far from over. It is evident in everyday brutal killings and senseless violence. Perpetrators of this evil seek legitimacy in the scriptures where none exist. No religion, none whatsoever, be it Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, Christianity, Sikhism, or Judaism, justifies violence and killing one human being by the other. They all talk in one language, and that is the language of peace, harmony, compassion, and kindness. The war on terror and radicalization is not against any religion and should never be. Quite on the contrary, it is against those who believe in destroying the creation of the Almighty. Ladies and gentlemen, We laud the leadership of President Rahmon in fighting terrorism and countering radicalization. You are a frontline state against the war on terror, and the world admires and respects your courage. We recognize the enormous challenges the Tajik security forces face every day. You have to fight terrorists and deal with those who are brainwashed by radical ideas. The hotbed of death and destruction is not far from you. You also have to contend with provocations to young minds, many of which are through the internet and social media. Ladies and gentlemen, the world that we Indians live in is not very different from yours. Terrorism does not believe in borders. India, like Tajikistan, is taking on terrorism and extremism head on. We too face the problem of radicalization, but we have been successful in dealing with it. It is not the question of how we have done, but rather why we have done, able to do it. I wish to share some of our experiences. Our inclusive society, where socio-economic partnership and participatory politics provide everybody an inherent sense of belonging to the nation, has been the most effective bulwark against radicalization. Our belief in pluralism, democracy, and secularism has been successful in trumping the ideology of hate and divisiveness. From the film industry to India's cricket team, and from the professional arena to politics, India is a land of equal opportunity and equal respect for all. A growing economy lifts one and all, leading to inclusive development. Our society has always believed in the power of ideas derived from our history, civilization, and culture. Our age-old values of Sufism, of humanism, have shielded us against dark and ugly designs. The call of our revered Sufi saint, Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia, I quote, "Almighty holds dear those who love him for the sake of human beings, and those who love human beings for the sake of Almighty," unquote, binds our social fabric. From our childhood, we are taught of oneness, of insaniyat as our creed, of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, meaning the world is one family. It is natural then that the invitation to destruction, even with its false but tempering narratives, generally does not appeal to the Indian mind. For a vast country that we are, I must share that those working overtime to infect us with their deadly virus have not succeeded and never will. I must also emphasize the positive role of family and education in preventing and countering radicalization of the youth in my country. Our family-based social structure, much like yours, is a guarantee against extremist ideas. We have witnessed tremendous resilience in our family as an institution, which has prevented vulnerable youth from getting drawn into the vortex of radicalization and terror. There have been cases where parents and relatives alerted authorities to save young targets from radicalization. Added to our family and community linkages, our religious leaders have also played a pivotal role in rejecting, condemning, and countering the narrative of hate and terror. Ladies and gentlemen, but we have to be ever vigilant against alienation. We have to ensure fairness and honesty in our approach, and we have to be cautious of the cyber world to prevent those who can go astray. This is challenging, no doubt, but with technology, with digital fingerprinting and algorithms, we can outdo the other. The politics of terror and radicalization to destabilize society is not the monopoly of non-state actors. India has been battling cross-border terrorism for long. If you recall your early days of civil war, I am certain that similar bitter memories will resurface. You could put those days behind you, successfully repelling unwanted intervention. Our close friend, Afghanistan, is not so lucky. Both India and Tajikistan must work together to bring peace and stability in Afghanistan and the entire region. India has deep and special historical ties with the Central Asian republics. Our relations with each of them are flourishing. Our shared past and our shared aspirations have got us together in a collective embrace. We are strengthening our security cooperation programs. We held the latest India-Central Asia dialogue in Samarkand. We are also engaging each other through regional platforms such as the Shanghai Cooperation Organization to tackle terrorism and extremism. India remains committed to collaborate bilaterally, regionally, and multilaterally to strengthen the global fight against terrorism. My dear students, today morning I met President Rahmon. We shared our common concerns on the security situation around us. I complimented him for the lead taken by Tajikistan in collaboration with the United Nations to counter radicalization. We also committed ourselves to defeating these forces. In this endeavor, we can do much to learn from each other, be it for our mobilization, effective social communication, imparting education, our interfaith dialogue and conversation. We must cooperate to choke the financing networks of terrorists and their likes. And we must strengthen our society cooperation and share best practices to counter radicalization. Trade and economic growth are long-term fundamentals on which peaceful societies prosper. Economic progress and equity act as a bulwark against the spread of radical ideas. We are determined to overcome the lack of our connectivity with Tajikistan and with Central Asia so that our economic relations grow and develop. We indeed have a stake in your progress and prosperity. Ladies and gentlemen, before arriving here, I had the honor to pay floral tributes at the bust of two great sons of India, Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore. Mahatma Gandhi has shown us the path of ahimsa, that is non-violence, and the words of Tagore teach us to shun parochialism. These are eternal values that we must share and we must live. I would like to conclude by drawing your attention to our shared heritage of humanism. The great Indian poet Mirza Abdul Qadir Bedri, who is remembered fondly in the lands of Amu and Sir Darya, he wrote, "Chist insan kamale kudrate isk, maniye kainato surte isk." Meaning, what is human being? Perfect expression of love. He is the true meaning of universe and face of love. If we instill this love for humanity in ourselves and spread the same to others, peace and love will prevail in our hearts, in our minds, and in our world. I wish all of you a bright future. Thank you and God bless you. Pasalo mat bolti.